Iliotibial friction syndrome is one of the most common sports injuries in the knee, and we see it especially in athletes who do a lot of repeated flexion-extension motions of the knee, like long-distance runners and long-distance cyclists. The iliotibial band is actually the prolongation of the iliotibial tract. The iliotibial tract runs from the lateral side of the pelvis to the lateral side of the knee, and in its mid-portion, it is relatively wide. It becomes more narrow at the level of the knee, and therefore we call it, in this area, the iliotibial band. As you can see, the iliotibial tract is connected to a small muscle. It's called the tensor fascia lata. But the iliotibial tract has also connections with the gluteus maximus and with the lateral side of the quadriceps, which is the vastus lateralis. And each of these muscular structures can tension the ITB. And that's important, because the more tense your ITB is, the more likely you could get a rubbing effect over the lateral side of the knee. Compare it with the string of a guitar. If the guitar string is really tight, it creates a lot of rubbing over the lateral edge of the knee, whereas when the string is loose, you get much less a tendency for a friction effect. So that means that any factor which contributes to tightening of the ITB will lead to an increased risk for ITB friction syndrome. And in athletes who have an ITB friction syndrome, you therefore need to correct these contributing factors, if you can at least. Some of the most important contributing factors is varus deformity, which is bow legs. In case you have a varus leg or a bow leg, it is not hard to imagine that the tension in the ITB is going to be high, certainly compared to when you have a valgus knee or knock knee. But also leg length difference, and especially the longest leg, is a contributing factor to ITB friction syndrome. The longest leg, obviously, is the leg with increased tension in the ITB, because of the obliquity of the pelvis. And therefore, athletes with a longer leg usually are predisposed to developing an ITB friction syndrome on their longest leg. And actually what happens is a friction over this area, the lateral epicondyle. As you can see, during each flexion extension, you get this potential rubbing effect. And the more tight the ITB is, the more this rubbing and friction effect will occur. To confirm the diagnosis of ITB friction syndrome, there exists a specific test, which is called the test of Noble. The test of Noble is executed by putting the examiner's finger on the lateral epicondyle and at the same time extend the knee from deep flexion to full extension. And as you see, in the beginning in deep flexion there is no pain, because the ITB is posterior to your finger. And then at this stage the pain is reproduced, but the pain disappears again when the knee is brought into further extension. So what happens is that the patient will report to the doctor a painful zone somewhere between 70 and 30 degrees of flexion, and we call that a painful arc. So the presence of a painful arc during this maneuver is diagnostic for an ITB friction syndrome, and we call it a positive test of Noble. Now, what are the symptoms of ITB friction syndrome? The symptoms are usually vague pain over the lateral side of the knee. Usually the patient cannot really pinpoint the exact location. Sometimes there is even more irradiation proximally or distally, but it is rather a vague area of pain, especially during training or during competition, when the athlete has already done quite some distance. Seldomly the pain is there immediately in the beginning, although the symptoms can already start to be there after a couple of minutes or so, certainly in the more severe cases. Because they have somewhat vague pain, we always have to exclude other pathology on the lateral side of the knee, the most important being a lateral meniscus tear. Because the lateral meniscus tear can also produce rather an aspecific vague pain on the lateral side, somewhat similar to ITB friction syndrome. And to exclude that there is a problem with the meniscus, we usually perform an MRI. On the MRI, we can easily see how much the ITB is damaged or inflamed. And as a matter of fact, we can do that also by ultrasound examination. With ultrasound, we can easily detect small thickening or small fluid invasion in the ITB, especially when we compare with the contralateral healthy side. You can easily pick up then any inflammation or thickening or damage of the IT band. Here you see some MRI examples of ITB friction cases. Sometimes the alterations are very subtle. Sometimes, like in severe cases, they are very obvious, like focal thickening of the ITB, bone edema on the lateral epicondyle due to the friction, and sometimes structural damage and even tearing of the ITB. Once you have made the diagnosis of ITB syndrome, you can treat the patient. And the treatment is at first instance reduction of training load or competition load. So you have to tell the patient that he or she has to reduce the activities that provoke the pain, certainly prolonged cycling and prolonged running. And at the same time, you can advise an anti-inflammatory treatment. For example, take non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medication. Never longer than 10 days in athletes, but also in normal people, never longer than 10 days because of the side effects. An alternative is to apply local, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory skin patches. You can apply them in the evening and remove them in the morning, so they have a 10 hours penetration of the medication. Actually, these medication patches are frequently very helpful because the ITB is located very superficially and just underneath the skin. So the medication in the patch doesn't have to penetrate it a lot of distance to be already effective. At the same time, you should correct any predisposing factors. For example, a small shoe lift or an insole in the shorter contralateral leg, which will make the pelvis parallel to the ground and therefore will reduce the ITB tension in the longer leg with the ITB syndrome. You can also try to correct the varus deformity somewhat by specific insoles in the shoe, which create a valgus effect at the knee and again reduce ITB tension. And of course, you should stretch the ITB and try to reduce the tension in the muscles that pull on the ITB. And these are, as I already said, the vastus lateralis, the tensor fascia lata, and the gluteus maximus. You can do that through a combination of specific stretches or releases using a hard ball or a foam roller, or, if needed, by dry needling. At the same time, you should strengthen the gluteus medius, as this muscle is what we call a short hip abductor. And therefore, if you can strengthen the gluteus medius, you can take away some of the work for the tensor fascia lata, and so you can further reduce the loads on the ITB. When all of this doesn't work, your doctor may consider a local infiltration with an anti-inflammatory agent or a corticosteroid. As you probably know, such a corticosteroid infiltration has a very strong anti-inflammatory effect. But it is also catabolic, which means that it will weaken the area where it is injected. So you can do this injection only once or twice, but not more often than that. If despite of all this, the patient still continues to complain, then he is a candidate for surgery. During surgery, we perform what we call a surgical release of the ITB, which means that we debride and clean up the damaged area and the scar tissue together with a lengthening of the ITB, which relieves the tension and dissolves the friction, and which also relieves the lateral retinacular nerve, which is a small terminal local nerve branch that gets squeezed during the friction process and which is probably one of the most important contributing factors to the pain. This procedure has a success rate of 85 to 90% of getting the patient symptom-free and cured and get him or her back to the sports arena. So with all this, you know how to diagnose ITB friction syndrome, and you know how to treat it. Thank you.